So we talked about the equations that define expectation maximization, and we stepped through an example with some actual data in the sense that it was data points. They weren't actual measured data points. But what I'd like to talk about now for a moment is some of the properties of the EM algorithm more generally. So one of the things that's good about it is that each time the iteration of EM runs, the likelihood of the data is monotonically non-decreasing. Right, so it's not getting worse. Generally, it's finding higher and higher likelihoods and kind of moving in a good direction that way. Unfortunately, even though that's true, it is not the case that the algorithm has to converge. I mean, have you ever seen it not converge? I've never seen it not converge.
No, because usually there's some kind of step that you take and you make the weight lower and lower. So yeah, or something like that. Yeah, no, I've never seen it not converge.
So it doesn't have to converge. I think you can construct really strange examples that make it do that. But on the other hand, so even though it doesn't converge, it can't diverge, right? It can't be that these numbers blow up and become infinitely large because it really is working in the space of probabilities. And it's pretty well behaved as far as that's concerned.
That's a difference between it and k-means, right? So the argument for k-means, if I recall, which feels like was about a week ago when we talked about this, but of course it was merely seconds ago, is that there's a finite number of configurations in k-means, and since you're never getting worse in our error metric, so long as you have some way of breaking ties, eventually you have to stop. And so that's how you got convergence, right?
Yeah.
So in EM, I guess the configurations are probabilities, and I guess there's an infinite number of those.
Yeah, you can do more than guess.
So in fact, there are an infinite number of those.
Exactly.
It wouldn't necessarily follow that you wouldn't converge from that. But that alone is one big difference, I guess, between the k-means and the EM. That's the trade-off you get for being able to put probabilities on things. So you've got an infinite number of configurations. You never do worse, but you're always trying to move closer and closer. So I guess what could happen is you could keep moving closer every single time, but because there's an infinite number of configurations, the step by which you get better could keep getting smaller. And so you never actually approach the final best configuration. I suppose that's possible. But for all intents and purposes, it converges.
Right, exactly. However, it can get stuck. And this you see all the time. I almost never not see it do this, which is to say that if there's multiple ways of assigning things to clusters, it could find a way that doesn't have very good likelihood, but can't really improve on very well. So there's a local optima problem that is pretty common. And so what do we do when we get stuck in local optima with a randomized algorithm?
Cry.
No.
We take all of our toys home and randomly restart.
There we go.
Okay.
And the last thing to mention is this is what you just suggested a moment ago on the previous slide, which is that there's nothing specific about Gaussians in here. It really is an algorithm that can be applied any time that we can work with a probability distribution. And so there's just a ton of different algorithms that work in different scenarios by defining different probability distributions. And then all you have to do is figure out what the E step and the M step are. How do you do expectation to work out the probability of the latent variables? And then how do you do maximization to use those latent variables to estimate parameters? And usually it's the case that it's the estimation that's expensive. It's difficult because it involves probabilistic inference, right? So it's just like Bayesian stuff.
Mm.
And the maximization is often just, you know, counting things. But it isn't in general the case that it's always harder to do E than M. There's some well-known examples where M is hard and E is actually quite easy. You know, for any given problem, you have some work to do to derive what the E and the M steps are. But it's very general. It's a good tool to have in your toolbox.
I like that. So basically, it's not that hard because it's just a small matter of math programming.
Indeed.